Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Medford United Methodist Church. It's good to have you with us. My name is Joe Monahan. I want to welcome you on behalf of myself and also our associate pastor, Kathleen Stoles. We're really happy to see you here with us this morning. I hope each one of you will take a minute. There's a red attendance pad that's on the inside of the pew. I hope that you'll pass it down to the end of the row and then pass it back towards the center. And as it passes by you, I hope you'll take note of the names of the folks who are seated around you. And if you're visiting with us this morning, we'd especially encourage you to share your names at the bottom of the page where there's a special section where you have some space to fill in your address information as well. We'd love to be able to let you know about things that are going on here at the church and hope that you'll give us the opportunity to do that. If you're looking for a new church home, we would welcome you here. You can learn more about our ministry by following us on Facebook. You can check us out on the website. And there's also some information out in the hallway as well. So we encourage you to do that. Some announcements here this morning that I want to lift up. First is the Safe Sanctuaries training. That's going to be offered today at 5 o'clock. And that's going to be held upstairs in the preschool area on this end of the building. And that's a requirement for under our Safe Sanctuaries policy for all those who are working with youth. And so we'd encourage you, if you're working with youth or you're working with children and you've not taken that class, we encourage you to come out. It does need to be renewed once a year. So thank you very much for doing that. The second thing that I'd like to lift up is that All Saints Sunday is coming up next Sunday. And this is a time, we're going to be doing this at all the services, where we remember all those of our loved ones who have died, especially those who have died in the past year. And so if there is a name that you would like to have lifted up during worship next week, we'd encourage you to do that. There are some instructions on how you can do that in the bulletin, so take a look at that. Send us an email in the church office, and we will make sure that your loved one is remembered in the service of your choosing next week. The third thing is we have a new members class that will be happening today right after this worship service, so about 12:15-ish, and childcare and lunch will be provided. So that will be taking place in down behind the offices in the classrooms back that way. And so we invite you to come out and join us for that. And the Eagles play tonight, in case you were wondering whether that was going to impinge on watching football. The Eagles play tonight at 8:30. So, yeah, you don't have to miss it. But we'd love to have you come and join us for our new members class. I think those are all the announcements that we've got. Kathleen?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I invite you to stand as you're able and join me in our call to worship. The kingdom of God is here and coming.
It is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, when it has grown, it becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches.
The kingdom of God is here and is coming.
It is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with three measures of flour until all of it was leavened.
The kingdom of God is here and coming.
It is like the treasure hidden in a field which someone found and hid, then enjoys, sells everything in order to buy that field.
The kingdom of God is here and coming.
It is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one of great value, sells all of his possessions to have that pearl.
The kingdom of God is here and coming.
Let all who have ears hear.
Thank you.
You may be seated. I invite you now to join me in our opening prayer. We gather here this morning, Lord, weary participants in a political process that seems more like a shouting match than a celebration of our common aim to improve the lives of millions who call this nation home. For our failure to love one another, to listen to one another, and to trust one another, Lord, forgive us. Unite us in the common hope for a day when justice, peace, health, and blessing will pour out upon the people of these United States and indeed the world. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. By faith and grace, we know that whenever we gather together, we are refreshed by the Spirit moving with us and by God's word given to us in Jesus Christ. With this knowledge, we move into the future as your people, affirming the Christ in ourselves and in each other. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let's take a moment now to greet those around us with the peace of Christ.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite our children to come forward now for our time together. Hello, how are you? Good? Did you know that life is full of choices? Yep. What kind of choices do you have to make? Good choices, right. That's the kind we want to make. Well, and healthy habits are the same kind of thing. Now, did you get to choose what you wanted to wear for Halloween? Yes. What did you choose? The Hulk?
Vader.
Okay, you know what? You guys are right there with the number one costumes of this year. You know, for years and years, princesses were the number one costume. But this year, according to the statistics, superheroes are the number one costumes of the year. And Star Wars is right up there, not just Darth Vader, but some of the other Star Wars figures too. So who knew? I didn't know that. So you guys made good choices as far as Halloween costumes go. But you know what? I think sometimes it's fun for people to dress up in costumes because we get to pretend we're somebody else. So you get to pretend you're the Hulk for a while, and you get to pretend you're Darth Vader for a while. For the night, that's right. Well, you know what? Another choice you have to make is, do you want to go trick-or-treating at night or when the sun is still out? That's one of the choices you have to make, right?
Yeah, at night.
You like to go at night. Okay. It's more fun to go trick-or-treating at night?
Yeah, because no one even goes in the morning.
But isn't it a little scary when you go at night?
No.
No? Oh, okay. Now, you also get to... The decorations can look scary. You also get to choose who you're going trick-or-treating with. So who are you going trick-or-treating with?
Daddy.
Daddy, okay. Who are you going trick-or-treating with? Oh, your fam. And some of your friends. We get to make all different kinds of choices. And like you said, Timmy, we want to make good choices, right, Brad? We want to make good choices, and sometimes we don't make good choices. But you know what? Jesus asked people to make choices too. And one of the best things we learned from Jesus is that when people make bad choices, Jesus still gave them a second chance. Jesus still loved them and tried to give them another chance. Now, at Halloween time, one of the most important choices you have to make, when you go to a house and they have more than one thing to offer you, how do you choose which treat to take? How do you choose?
If you're allergic to peanut butter and there's no peanut butter, you can take it.
That's right. So you have to watch out if you've got allergies. You've got to make a really good choice, right? How do you choose what kind of treat you want? Well, you know what? I brought something today. It's all kind of the same treat, but it looks different colors. Okay? So you get to choose which color you would like. Okay? But don't eat it now. You have to save it for after lunch. Okay? Okay? And God made sure that we always have good choices. We always have bad choices. We have choices that we can make. But even when we make choices that aren't so good, God's going to love us anyway. And just like your mom and dad will love you no matter what choice you make, but we always hope that you make good choices. Let's say a prayer before you go back to your seat, okay? God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to make choices. We pray that you'll help us make good choices, but we give you thanks that you love us no matter what choices we make. Amen. Okay, you can go back to your seats. And Barb, for the choir, after. Can you? Yep, go ahead.
Thank you. and angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. Oh Lord, we would render, oh help us to see. 'Tis only the splendor of light hides a beam.
Praise God, O Lord, all blessings, all His blessings more. Praise Him, O creatures, here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts, Father, Son, Holy Ghost.
Scripture reading today comes from Luke chapter 17, verses 20 through 21. Once, Jesus was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God was coming. And he answered, "The kingdom of God is not coming with things that can be observed, nor will they say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There it is.' For in fact, the kingdom of God is among you." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
So for all of the liturgists who have had to suffer through reading 10, 20, 25 verses, you know, you guys didn't get lucky. That's all I can say. So earlier this year, I preached a couple of sermons about faith and politics, and that was back in July. And if I can sum up those, you know, I really try very much to be able to have a sermon that, when I'm all done, you can say it in a sentence, okay? So if I can say those two sermons in two sentences, the first one would have been, first, faith ought to inform our voting. That was number one. And then the second one was really about this idea, that the best way to survive this election season is to learn how not to be a jerk, right? Do you remember those two verses, or those two sermons? So let's take a minute, and we're going to continue this series. I thought it would be a good thing to have just have one more opportunity to think about this before the election. So let's take a minute and let's pray together. God, we are grateful for all that you've done. We're grateful for your work in our lives, and ask that you be at work in these words that I speak, in the thoughts of our hearts as we consider the scripture and consider what it is that you are saying to us. Lord, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So, show of hands, how many of you have experienced the following, any one of the following, this election season? How many of you have stopped seeing people that you previously were hanging out with because you were tired of talking politics with them? Anybody? No, not yet. How many of you have, the choir, maybe? No. How many of you have unfriended or muted somebody on Facebook because they were annoying you? Okay. That's pretty much everybody. How many of you have experienced where an evening with your family was ruined because somebody got into a political argument? How many of you? Yeah? Okay. So, my mom, who is 80 this year, I was just home, and that was about a week ago, and we were talking about this election, and my mom said to me, "I've never seen it like this in all the elections that I've seen." And some people who have been in some of the previous services, you know, who are that old and older, have said the same thing to me. People are so sick of the election that in states where there is early voting, people have been out the door, just anxious to get this over with and be done and to be able to let it go and not have to think about it anymore. The American Psychological Association recently did a survey, and what they found was that for 52% of Americans, this election represents a significant form of stress. Okay, a significant amount of stress is being injected into their lives just because of the election. Now, here's a little bit of advice that they shared in their press release that I thought was interesting. Whatever happens on November 8th, life will go on. Our political system and the three branches of government mean that we can expect a significant degree of stability immediately after a major transition of government. Avoid catastrophizing and maintain a balanced perspective. I love that word, catastrophizing. That's my new favorite word, I think. So I guess they're calling out, in a way, all those people who are threatening to move to Canada, right? I don't know what makes anybody think that Canada is ready to welcome millions of Americans with open arms. I'm not really sure why they believe that, but okay, whatever. If you want to believe that, that's fine. I hear another word that's important in there, in that piece from the American Psychological Association, and that is perspective. Perspective. So if you want perspective, here's something I would encourage you to think about and maybe do in the next couple days. Something that occurred to me yesterday is something that I might do to gain some perspective. I looked up Lincoln's first and second inaugural addresses online, and I read them. Now, Lincoln's not known for being someone who went on for hours and hours, so it won't take you forever to read them. In fact, Lincoln's second inaugural is shorter than the sermon. But I'd encourage you to take a look and just compare his speech to what we hear today. Consider the tone of it, consider the language, consider just the level of discourse at which he is talking about issues that matter. You'll find there's no comparison with what we're doing right now. No comparison. And secondly, and perhaps more importantly, I'd invite you to remember this fact, that when Lincoln stood to take the oath of office in March of 1861, 7 states had already seceded from the Union. So I guess my first point might be that the times that we live in are remarkable, but as a nation, we have seen worse, and we have weathered much worse. So I think that's an important place to start, an important thing to remember. And I think that this gets me to my main point, which is both an historical point and a theological point. Now, I'm not sure that anyone, even and perhaps especially not Lincoln himself, if he were asked, I'm not sure that he would have thought of the Civil War in these terms. But I think at this historical distance, we can talk about the Civil War as a moment where we failed as a nation to live up to our own highest ideals as we expressed them when we started this country in the Declaration of Independence. So in that document where Jefferson says that it's self-evident that all of us are created equal, self-evident that we are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. Now, Jefferson wrote these things while at that point 20% of the population of the United States was enslaved. 20%. So there has always been a gap between our ideals in our reality. There's always been a gap there. And sometimes it's a very significant gap. That's the space, though, in which we live. Right up to this day, that's the space in which we live. It's the space that we occupy. And so, that's why the framers protected our right to protest. That's why they gave us, for example, a means to amend the Constitution, because they understood that no matter how hard they tried, that no political system is perfect. The Constitution begins by saying, in order to form a more perfect union, recognizing that, hey, there were flaws in what we tried before. There were flaws in the Articles of Confederation. Let's see if we can do it better. Because the nation is always a work in progress. It's always in the process of becoming something new. Now, it's true that when we look at our choices of candidates, many of us worry about what it is that we are becoming. If we're on the road to becoming, we question, what is it that we're becoming exactly? We long for something that's better. And honestly, I do believe that we should expect better of our candidates, of our leaders. We should expect better of ourselves, to be quite honest. But I would also argue that for some time, both sides of the political spectrum, both the left and the right, have been asking government to do things that government was never designed to do. On the right hand, to enforce righteousness. Government was never designed to do that. And on the left hand, to guarantee perfect justice. Again, government is not capable of doing that. So in short, what I'd say is that on both ends of the spectrum, we have been guilty of thinking that our republic is the same thing as the kingdom of God. We've fallen into the trap of believing that this nation, that our republic, is the same thing as the kingdom of God. We've grown accustomed to believing that we can achieve God's ends with this very blunt instrument, which is government. And so that's the reason why, for example, famous pastors have become important political figures, sought after for their endorsements. Nobody's come knocking on my door, fortunately. So we've forgotten something really important. Does anybody remember what Jesus says in John chapter 18? Pilate says to him, "Are you a king?" And Jesus responds, "My kingdom is not of this world." Now that's one of the few times in John where Jesus actually speaks of the kingdom. In the other Gospels, he's talking about the kingdom constantly. All the time he's talking about it. He tells parables about it, where he compares it to seeds. He compares it to treasures. He compares it to yeast. He describes it as a vineyard. He describes it at one point as a fishing net. The kingdom is, in fact, the main point of his preaching. So what Matthew says is that after John the Baptist exits the scene, and John the Baptist is described as preaching, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And what does it say when Jesus picks up that mantle and that mission and continues that preaching? It says his message was exactly the same as John's. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But as you can imagine, the people who were listening to Jesus tell these stories day in and day out, they kind of got tired of him just painting these pictures with words, and they wanted him to be a little bit more concrete. And so they came to him and they asked him questions like, "Well, what is this kingdom exactly that you're talking about? When will it appear? Who's going to be in it? Who's going to be out of it?" They wanted to know these kinds of things. And these were the kinds of questions that Jews had been asking, that rabbis had been debating for a long time. They might have used slightly different language. They talked about this age versus the age to come. They talked about the time of the Messiah, the days of the Messiah. What would those things look like? How would we know that the Messiah was among us? But the ideas were all very, very similar. And so the Pharisees, The legal experts, they hear Jesus talking about all of this, and they recognize that language. They try to pin Jesus down. They say, how will we know that the kingdom is here, Jesus? This kingdom that you keep talking about, how will we know that it's here? And Jesus says, what do you mean? It's not coming with things that you can see. If someone says to you, look, here it is, or if someone points and says, look, there it is, don't believe them. The kingdom of God is among you. Among you as in, it's already here. Now, there are three main ways to translate this phrase. There's among you, there's in your midst, and then there's within you. If you pick up any Bible, you will find one of those three translations in all likelihood. It's hard for me to imagine, even though it might appeal to us, this idea of within you. Say the kingdom of God is within you. Well, that's very spiritual sounding, is it not? The kingdom of God is within you. We like that. But here's the problem. Jesus is addressing the Pharisees. They're the ones who ask the question. And so to imagine that Jesus, who's very skeptical of the Pharisees' spirituality, would say, the kingdom of God is within you, Pharisees, that's almost impossible for me to imagine. Because he wouldn't trust them with that. So it's got to mean something else. What I think it means is he's saying, it is among you, as in, it's here because I'm here. It's wherever I am. That's where the kingdom of God is. Now, this is different from some other passages and some other parables that Jesus tells where he talks about the kingdom as something that's out there in the future. In the latter part of Matthew's gospel, he talks about the idea that no one knows the hour or the time when the kingdom will come. He's not sure. Even Jesus says, I don't know. But he still speaks of it confidently, knowing that it is coming. It's on its way. So let's sum up what we know then about this kingdom, as contradictory as these ideas might be. So there is a kingdom. It is among us now, but it's also something that we are waiting for God to bring. It's coming with things that cannot be seen, and yet it is within us. Jesus is a king, and yet his kingdom is not of this world. Now, how do you put all of this together? Because it seems pretty important to put all of this together if it is, in fact, true that the biggest part of Jesus' teaching is about the kingdom. How do we understand this? And to get back to my point, how does any of this relate to an election? Well, one way that theologians talk about the kingdom is to talk about it as something that is both already and not yet. Already and not yet. I believe that we can see some evidence of the kingdom wherever we see God's love at work in the world, wherever we see the love of Jesus Christ transforming lives, whenever we see the Spirit's power loose in people, we see it whenever Christ's love calls us as sinners to repentance. We see it wherever Christ's love calls enemies to the table of peace. We see it wherever Christ's love calls those who have been hurt to a place where they can forgive. We see it wherever Christ's love calls those who are trapped and stuck in their own hate to be able to come to a place where they can learn how to love. So Jesus is right to shout. Don't believe those who say, here it is or there it is, because it is elusive. It's kind of like a rainbow. Right? You see a rainbow in the sky, but if the sun changes just a little bit, now it's gone. The humidity changes just a little bit, now it's gone. It appears, it's beautiful, it's there for a moment, and then you say, what happened? Now, some people through history have looked at the church and said, look, here it is. This is the evidence of God's kingdom on earth. It's the church. Now, do you believe that? I believe it's true of us on our best days. But I also believe that for the most part, we're equally likely in churches to encounter things that are contrary to the kingdom of God. And that hurts me to say it, but I think it's true. We are not the kingdom because we are hypocrites just as much as everyone else is hypocrites. We are all sinners in one way or another. And so to come back to my point, if even the church cannot be called the kingdom of God 100% of the time, then why in the world would we ever expect a government to be able to be like the kingdom of God 100% of the time? How could we ever expect that? How could we ever even think that that were the case? No candidate in this race is going to meet all of your expectations. Perhaps none of the candidates in this race have met any of your expectations. So what do? We study the issues, we study the people, we pray, and we vote. That's what we do. And you've got to expect along the way that somewhere politicians will disappoint you. And just the same way that pastors will disappoint you, that teachers will disappoint you, that your parents will disappoint you, that your families will disappoint you. People in your life will disappoint you. As a nation, we live in this place that is somewhere between the already and the not yet. The idea of our ideals and not quite living into them is very much akin to the idea of the kingdom of God. The already and the not yet. So as a nation, we see these flashes of brilliance where we say, that is what the founders intended. That is what the framers put in place, and that's why it works. And we are grateful for it. And then there are other times when we say, if they were so wise, how did they not see this coming? How did they not anticipate this? We still fail to live up to our ideals of liberty and justice for all. We do, every day. We are a nation that's still a work in progress, in the sense that the church is still a work in progress. So as you go to the polls, remember this. Jesus is not on the ballot. And in fact, Jesus wouldn't want to be on the ballot. He wouldn't. I can prove it from Scripture. So from John chapter 6, Jesus feeds the 5,000, and it says, they came to make him king by force, but he fled. He refused. He wasn't going to take power for himself. He does not want to be on your ballot. He doesn't even want you to write him in. So we're not voting to usher in the kingdom of God. What we are voting for is someone that we hope and we pray will take this job seriously and do their best. That's what we're hoping for. That's what we're praying for. That's what we need. And when we go to the polls, what may very well happen is that my vote and your vote may cancel each other out. You may go to the polls and find that your vote and your spouse's vote may cancel each other out. That does not mean that one of you is crazy. That does not mean that one of you is wrong. If your candidate loses, do not catastrophize, right? Because Christians can, and they will disagree about how politics can be used and should be used to further the ends that God intends for us as people. So let me leave us with this hope and with this prayer from the closing lines of Lincoln's second inaugural. To be honest, we could share the lines from Lincoln's first inaugural just as easily. But here's what he says. With malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right. Let us strive on to finish the work that we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Amen. As we prepare to worship God with our gifts and our tithes and our offerings, I just want to let you know about a fundraiser that we're doing right now to provide some funding for our adult mission trip that's going to be taking place in January. We're going to be sending a team to West Virginia to help with flood relief efforts there and flood recovery efforts from the floods that ravaged that state a little while ago. And this is a really simple concept, a really simple fundraiser. As you go out through the front doors, there are some envelopes on a board. And each one of those envelopes has a number on it, an amount that we encourage you to put into that envelope and return back to the church. And if we were to fill all of those envelopes, the total amount is something over $11,000. So we invite and encourage you to take part in that with us and help us in our goal of sending a team to West Virginia. Let's continue now by offering God our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. If you're visiting with us this morning, we want to say thank you so much for being here, and you don't need to feel obligated to put anything in the plate. We're happy to have you and look forward to seeing you again in the very near future.
pray with me. God of grace, we hear your call to generous giving in the way you meet our needs each day and in the peace you give which passes understanding. Having received so much, we offer all we have, our time, talents, and money for your kingdom. Bless these gifts for the work of your church. Amen. You may be seated.
As we get ready to go into a time of prayer, I want to share with you a couple of joys and a couple of concerns. I want to celebrate, and I forgot to lift this up at the previous services, but we have a great joy in that Lisa, our office manager, her daughter, Stephanie, got married this weekend, so we want to celebrate with them. That was a great, great thing. Seen some pictures on Facebook, looked like they had a great time, and I had the privilege of doing the premarital counseling with Stephanie and with her husband, Steve, so I was excited about that. I want to lift up a couple of prayer requests, and the first one is for Justin Curtis, the grandson of Gordon and Linda, who's going to be going into CHOP for a procedure that's going to require a 4 to 6 week stay. And so Justin is 14 years old. We want to pray for him. We want to pray for Wayne Shantz, who's connected to several families here in the church. We want to lift up Wayne in prayers for his health. We pray for Douglas Eaton, who's moved with joy to Texas, and they're building a new home there. So we want to pray for them. And finally, we want to pray for the wife of co-worker of one of our families who's in ICU today. So let's take some time now. We'll begin with a time of silence, and then let's offer these prayers and our prayers as a body to the Lord. God, you hear our concerns. When we come before you, you know the concerns that we have for ourselves, for our families, for our church, for this nation, and for all the nations. But as we gather today, we want to lift up this election, this process that we go through to select our leaders. And we pray for fairness, we pray for openness, we pray for honesty. We pray for your guidance and leadership as we select leaders for the future of the nation. We just pray that you'll be at work in our hearts and in our minds, that we might understand what it is that you need us to understand, what is true and what is good. Lord, we are grateful for your power at work in us. We're grateful for the Spirit that you send to guide us, and pray that you will guide us. Lord, you've heard the concerns that we've lifted for people that we know and people that we love. We pray too for people that we don't know at all, for those who are struggling with difficult diagnoses today, for those who are dealing with the loss of loved ones, for those who are unemployed and seeking employment, but for those who are struggling in addiction, for those who have sunk into despair, we lift up the people around the world who are dealing with things that we can't imagine today. We pray for the people of Italy who are recovering from another earthquake today. Lord, we pray that you be with them. And for people in Haiti and throughout Southern United States who have dealt with losses associated with hurricanes. Lord, we're grateful for your power and the way that you work in our lives to encourage us to be in ministry with our fellow human beings. And we give you thanks for the ways in which you ministered to us through others after Sandy. We remember that storm 4 years ago, and we think about all those who are still in need of help. So we pray that you continue to work through us. Lord, we celebrate the good things in our lives. We celebrate the beauty of this day, the beauty of this season. We celebrate our young people as they take part in all their activities and all their sports and everything that we go out to cheer them on for. And we give you thanks for Stephanie and Steve and ask your blessing upon their marriage today. And Lord, in everything, we pray that you help us to be the most effective witnesses that we can be, so that people might be able to look at us and say, there is evidence of the kingdom. Lord, we pray that you might be at work and that you might surround us with your work. We trust that you are among us. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Reminder, if you want to join us for the new members class, it'll be down in this part of the church. There are a couple of classrooms back here that we'll be in. And as you go forth from this place, go forth to be the evidence of Christ's kingdom come on earth. Go forth where people can point to your life and say, look, here's something that proves to me God is real. God changes people. God does amazing things. Go forth in the peace and the power of Christ. Amen.